perhaps it's got a bit more interest, might be the word you might use there, to the sound of it. Now I'm just going to give it a blow and see where it's sitting. So again, it's a little bit slow. So I'm just going to bring that languid down a little bit more. I'll turn it around so you can see me as I do it. So it's now got a, what I would describe in musical terms, we describe sounds of organ builders and voices in one word terms, and I would call this sound warm, probably, and this sound I'd call a bit sort of strained at the moment. So I'm going to cut it up just a little bit more just to try and take that sort of strained tone out of it. And then obviously in cutting it up you take the chamfer away and you have to put it back on. So it's still a little bit on the slow side with it doing that kind of gurgling noise. So I'll just knock the languid down a little bit more. So it's now going up onto a top tube. Now, with tip-regulated pipes, if you go too far with your languid and push it down too much, you obviously can't get things up the foot if the feet are very closed. And we use this special tool here, which if you go to B&Q, it's in the plaster, a small tool aisle. We call it, in organ building, a languid lifter. And you would kind of put that down the slot, down the tube, and just gently lever up the languid again. Obviously with this pipe having the bottom lip shoved right into the flue, what we don't want to do is sort of put indentations on the languid edge, because it isn't nicked. We don't want to disturb what is essentially, from the tip, a ribbon of air coming up the flue, which splits on the top lip. So it's a very fine, as Downs describes it in Brock, it's a ribbon of air. So we have to use a languid rod. So voicing in this style is very sort of labour intensive and painstaking, because if you go too far, you've actually got to pick the pipe up and get this out and stick it up the foot and very gently knock the languid back up without disturbing the languid edge. But hopefully I mightn't have gone too far. As you'll see. So back on its wind. So it's kind of turning over on itself there. So I'm going to knock the bottom limb in just a little bit more, just to try and calm that down. And in doing that, it controls the speech a little bit more, but also makes the pipe a little bit quieter. And you can hear that it's got that very fine sort of onset chiff to it. But it's still erring towards going onto its octave. So again, to round that out a little bit more, I cut it up just a twitch more to take that away. Obviously in the workshop I'd probably leave it as it was, because I can always do this on site and it can't be undone. Well, it can be undone, but the metal shop don't really like that. I'm just going to knock this up a little tiny bit now with the rod. So there's the same, almost the same timbre. Very different. And of course that's just lost its drive there, so I'll just pull its bottom lip out just a tiny, tiny bit, just to give it a bit of colour back in its cheeks. So there's two pipes, physically identical, and everywhere. Those with perfect pitch will probably know that that isn't a C. It's round about a B, I think, but the metal shop always make them too long. So that's open tip and closed tip voicing. So what can I tell you a little bit about how that kind of what I've just done there translates to the work we're doing on the organ? Of course, with tip regulation when the pipework comes out of the oven and goes back to the workshop and gets cleaned, you can be, brutal is not the right word, but you can be a bit less delicate in the handling of the pipework, because it's a bit more robust because the tips are open or closed and controlled, but it's the mouth which is more important. And when you clean these pipes, you've got to be very careful with the open tip style of voicing like we have here to not alter the relationship of the bottom lip to the mouth. Because you get back to the building here, and just through washing a pipe like that, the regulation of how loud they are between the neighbours kind of goes all a bit at sea. And there's no point putting pipework like that on the voicing machine in the workshop to kind of re-establish where it is. So we've left all of the way the pipes speak until we get back in the building. And of course we began with the left section of the organ. It must be 18 months or so ago, if not more, probably more. I'm looking at William. Can you remember when that went in? That bit. It seems so long ago since it came out, it's quite incredible really. So we put that section of the organ in, and of course what you can see at the moment is we've got this huge gap here, and if you imagine the middle section missing as well, the way that the chamber kind of works is it's a huge acoustical anomaly, in that the organ was rattling around in that chamber there, and of course the stage crew here were using behind the wall there is a lovely junk room. So when you came to tune the organ, the main access to the organ was from the door that side, and it was like a crippling factor to get to the organ before you'd even done a day's tuning. So that section went in, and you have seen on the video this morning our little tuning keyboard with all the little switches on. We developed that actually for here. And when you read Baroque Tricks, it talks about down sitting in the stalls and having someone at the keys and the men at the organ doing the work on the pipes, and here we'd be calling to them. Obviously these days we can't do that, it's too expensive. So we developed this keyboard which allows us to just get away from the organ and hear it firsthand down here, get it absolutely right without wearing the hole in the stage, running back and forth to listen to it. And when we did that first stage of the work, this was very much a building site in here still. The hall was on the verge of reopening. The seating wasn't in when the organ, that left section was put in. And our men were working nights, so during the day it was a hub of activity here with builders, plumbers, carpenters, electricians. And then they would all go home and our men would turn up. And of course the dust overnight on the top of the console, you could write your name in it by the morning, the dust settling. So you can imagine being in here all night, you became very dry and hoarse. So that section went in and was then all voiced using this machine. We actually had it down there because the stage at that time was still being built. And we went down there and we regulated the organ to a degree to get it somewhere near until the rest of the building was back to normal. Once that was back to normal, we came in again and we went through pulling things right. But not having the middle section, everything towards the right-hand edge of the great organ there was kind of speaking into this open space. But the organ had to come into use for, in a limited sense, for the orchestral concerts. So we kind of got it going. And we put this middle section in over the space of 1 week with a team, as William was saying this morning, working round the clock. And two teams taking over from each other. And there is a stop motion video of that on the Pull Out All the Stops website if you haven't seen it. And there was a one camera in the stalls here and a camera up there taking a photograph every 2 or 3 minutes, which was put together into a video montage of the organ going in and rather speeded up, which was, it's great to watch. But what you must watch for in that video was the blue ball, which was left over from the from some of the production in here, and the blue ball kind of goes across the stage. But what they cut out of that film was the cones walking across the stage towards the end when we were having a bit of fun. But there you go. So we got that middle section in, and the pipework all came in, and then I came with my colleague, Dr. Matthews, to work on the organ. And of course, what's vitally important to this instrument is continuity. I talked earlier about the tuning of the celestes that have been passed down by Downs. And not just that, but many of the things that were passed down. And of course, my predecessor as head boy, Sir Peter Hopps, he actually worked with Downs. I would love to meet Downs today and shake his hand, really, and just glean a few things from him. And it's very interesting working on this pipework. So we got Peter to come down to see what we were up to here and get his pearls of wisdom and several of his jokes that we heard a dozen times before that. So the continuity is hugely important to the success of this project. So back to these pipes, I'm going to let you hear them a little bit more, and then what I'm going to do is let the stage crew get some microphones and then maybe you can ask any questions. If I don't know the answers, I'll make them up. There you go. So, close tip voicing again. Very round, very warm. And open tip. It's got that slight cough under its speech. So, there you go. That's, in a nutshell, roughly how it's done. Next time it'll be over to you to have a go. So, if the stage crew are around somewhere with a microphone, lovely, here we go. Does anyone have any questions? You can't all be that shy.